Thanks to all the organizers of this series. I've had a very fun time here today. So thanks for inviting me. Christy, I also want to thank you for putting me in a lecture series on the development of belief systems. This is, I think, particularly relevant to the talk that the work I'm going to be talking about today, because I really think that the most distinctive thing about our species is this incredible, prolific capacity we have for carving out whole new domains of knowledge and then developing systematic, interconnected, productive sets of beliefs within those domains. Now, clearly, we're animals, and all animals have to know things about the world. They have to know how to find food, and who's going to be a friend, and who's going to be a foe, and so forth. But I think what really the single thing that might most distinguish our species is the way we create these new domains of knowledge that never existed before. Some of them that are only kind of distantly can be perceived as useful, even like, I don't know, knowledge about World of Warcraft or sports or chess or things like that. Some of which, like science and the arts and mathematics, that turn out to be tremendously useful. But in all of these cases, I think what you see is this productive human capacity we have to create new sets of beliefs about the world. And I think that capacity raises four general questions that I want to focus on today. The first question is what is it about us that leads us on this very different path from all these other animals? We have very similar, as Eleanor Gibson taught me, we have very similar perceptual systems to many other animals, similar action systems, and then we come up with these very, very different belief systems. What is it that leads to that? Now, at the center of our most important new belief systems are a set of abstract ideas. And abstract ideas are pretty peculiar. You can sort of come to see how we might come to have new ideas about concrete, perceptible properties of the world. We look out at the world, we observe regularities, and we come to remember them and generalize them to new situations. But how do you learn about a dimensionless point, a point that's so small that no perceptual system could ever detect it, or about moral goodness? That's not a quality that you can read off someone by looking at their perceptible characteristics. Yet we not only come to have ideas like that, these ideas come to be some of the most important ideas we have. The notion of a point is absolutely central to our ideas about geometry and notions of goodness to our ethics. Where do these ideas come from? How do we come to have them? Next question. In all of our knowledge domains, including both the really important central ones and the more peripheral ones, we don't just grow knowledge by learning new collections of facts that we add to the old facts that we already had stored. Rather, in many cases, what we discover as our knowledge grows is that we need to reorganize it, and we need to pick out new concepts and relate them to each other in new ways. This happens most clearly in the history of science, where the very sensible division that early scientists made between the Earth, which was flat and a ground, and the heavens, which included the sun and the moon and the stars, got totally reorganized into concepts of planets, which included not only the moon but the Earth, and suns, which included not only our sun but the stars, right? I mean, very different way of reorganizing things. But how does that happen? You can sort of see how if you have a concept of an apple but you've never seen a green apple before, then you see a Granny Smith apple for the first time and you can learn, okay, this is similar to other apples, I'll put it in the same category. But how do we use what we know to change what we know, to reorganize our knowledge in terms of new concepts? That's the third question. And then the fourth question, all of these phenomena suggest, and I think our common sense experience suggests, that human knowledge is highly variable, both across current human cultures and also over historical and prehistorical time. We're very, very flexible. Yet it also seems that there might be some unifying properties to human nature, to our minds, and the kinds of beliefs that we come to have. And what might those human constant properties be? Okay, now having heard an absurdly over-the-top introduction, you might think I'm going to answer these questions. I'm not going to answer these questions. Here's what I want to do in this talk. I want to suggest that although I can't give you answers to these questions now, they are answerable. And I think they're not answerable in some faraway sense that maybe your great-great-great-great-grandchildren will answer them. I think they're questions we can already make headway on, and some of them may come to satisfying answers within your lifetimes. And in particular, I want to make two general suggestions about work that's going on right now that I think can get us closer to an answer to those four questions. And first of all, let me point to the work that Christy's engaged in and I'm engaged in and many of the people in this room are engaged in, studying the origins and development of knowledge in infants children and in relation to the knowledge that we have as adults. I think classic studies within cognitive and developmental psychology of the development of human cognition can shed light on these questions, can get us closer to answering them. That's message number one. But here's message number two. I actually don't think that any of these questions is going to be answered by work within developmental psychology alone, or even by work within psychology alone. I think we're going to get to the answers to these questions only by engaging in interdisciplinary efforts where we triangulate in on those answers by looking at the same phenomena, human beliefs, human systems of knowledge, from multiple different disciplinary perspectives. And in particular, I think we're likely to make headway from three different kinds of comparative research that join the basic kind of comparison that developmental psychologists make, comparisons between people and what they know at different ages. The first of these is research that looks at people, human beings, and what they know and how they think and what belief systems they hold as they vary across the cultures that people live in, the experiences they have, such as whether they have an opportunity for formal education or not, the kinds of perceptual and cognitive capacities they have, so whether people have access to auditory as well as visual information about the world, and their ways of processing the information that they're getting. People with different developmental disabilities who process information in different ways. So I think work within the clinical sciences, within anthropology, within comparative linguistics and other fields, looking at these sources of human variability and asking what's the same and what's different across people with different capacities and people in different circumstances can be very illuminating. The next comparative enterprise compares our species to other species of animals. I won't talk very much about that today, but I think we learn an awful lot by asking in what ways are our ways of understanding the world the same as those of other animals, and in what ways are they different. Where we find sameness between us and other animals, we have animal models, which we can then exploit to learn more about our human cognitive capacities. And where we find differences, we get hints as to what kinds of qualities distinguish our minds from those of other animals. Where we see the sameness in animal models brings me to the last kind of comparison, which is comparisons across levels of analysis, from genes to neurons to brain circuits to computations. And I think a whole panoply of work in the neurosciences, in other areas of biology, and in the computational sciences, notably the successes recently in machine learning and artificial intelligence, can be extremely useful if we can harness them in relation to work in these other areas to zero in on the answers to these questions. So looking across all of these areas, I think we see lots of cases in which research has not converged, but I think we see a few cases in which research converges to suggest that there are basic systems of knowledge at work in young human minds that continue to play a central role in our minds as adults. These are what, as Christy said, I call systems of core knowledge, and in particular, if I had to make my bets now, I would bet on six of them. I think there's a system of core knowledge of number focused on allowing us to develop representations of sets and their approximate numerical magnitudes. I think there's a system for representing objects, tracking them over time, and making sense of their mechanical interactions with each other. And in order to assess the interactions of different objects, we need to be able to represent different objects in parallel, maintain representations of different objects in parallel, and I think we can do that up to about three or four of them. There's a system, I think, for representing our location in the spatial layout, a system that we use for figuring out where we are and how we get from where we are to other places in the environment. And another system that also focuses on the geometrical structure of the world around us, but in contrast to the first of these two systems, which focuses on large-scale geometry, it focuses on the small-scale shapes of objects. And finally, I think there's two systems of social knowledge, one that focuses on people and other living animate beings as agents who cause changes in the world and do so by acting with respect to goals, efficiently with respect to goals. And a second is a system for representing the people in our social world as beings with phenomenal states who attend to us, engage with us, and share states of attention and emotion. Those are my votes for six systems that we can find in infants that I think continue to exist in us throughout life. These systems, I suggest, are innate, and all I mean by innate, not anything magical or mysterious, that just means that these systems are present and functional on first encounter with the objects that they serve to represent. So the first time a baby has the experience of looking in someone else's eyes, seeing a social being and becoming engaged with that being, this system is already functioning. It's not shaped by a history of prior encounters. It's ready to go on first encounters with its objects. I think these systems exist continuously over development, as I said, and therefore are universal across cultures. But two more important properties of these systems, and I'll really be focusing on this today, is their limits. I think, first of all, each one of these systems, these basic core early developing systems, provides us with only very skeletal, partial, limited information about the entities that it serves to represent. Second, every one of these systems, as far as we can tell from current research, is shared by other animals. None of them are unique to us. If that's right, it follows that these core knowledge systems by themselves can't be the sole source of our uniquely human cognitive achievements. Because other we have them from the beginning, but so do other animals, and yet we end up going on very different paths. And that brings me to the second general message for today, which is that in addition to those core knowledge systems, I think humans construct new systems of knowledge in uniquely human ways. I think some new knowledge systems emerge only in adults, but others emerge over childhood. And of the ones that emerge over childhood, some of them start to emerge before kids engage in formal education. They don't require explicit teaching. They emerge spontaneously in kids. And in particular, I think there are three such candidates that have been studied a lot. One is the system of natural number. Another, the system of Euclidean plane geometry that we use for reasoning about points, lines, and simple figures, planar figures. And a third is a system of mental state reasoning, reasoning about other people as actors whose actions are guided by their beliefs and motivated by their desires. I think these are all common sense systems that everyone in the world, people come to construct over the course of childhood. They're not there at the beginning. But I think these systems build over childhood by building on the core knowledge systems and do so through processes that we're starting to understand, although we don't understand them fully. My hope is that if we did understand them better, we'd be able to go back and give clearer answers to some of those four initial questions that I started with. So what I want to do today, because this I hope this is only going to last, my talk will only last an hour, not the next, I don't know, 3 or 4 hours or whatever, is narrow the field from what's on this slide and focus on just one core knowledge system, and I'll choose this approximate number system to focus on, and one constructed knowledge system. The positive integers or so-called natural numbers that children come to use in counting enumerating sets of objects exactly. I'll focus just on them and try to use that as a case study to lay out some of the evidence for the two general substantive claims that I'm making, namely, one, that there are core systems of knowledge present early in development and functioning throughout development, and two, that we construct new systems of knowledge by building on those core systems and bringing them together. Okay, so natural number, extremely useful and interesting domain. I would argue it's a critical tool for just about all of our human cultural achievements. An interesting exercise would be, think about one interesting, important, distinctive cultural achievement that doesn't use natural number concepts. It's hard. I mean, even things like rating people on the web, on social networks and things like that, right? It's all number. I mean, number seems to be everywhere. It seems to be involved in all of our other achievements. It centers on prime example, you know, clear examples of abstract concepts, concepts that don't have corresponding perceptual correlates or action correlates. It's a foundation for all sorts of things that we do learn in school, like formal mathematics. And over the course of engaging in that learning, we see beautiful examples of conceptual change, even more dramatic than the changes involved in reorganizing from the earth versus the heavens to the stars versus the planets. Above all, the natural number system is really simple. Two axioms, one is a number, and if n is a number, then n plus one is a number, is all you need to generate all of them. Okay, it's a very, very simple system. So it looks like a good place to start to try to look at how we come to have this new system of knowledge in this domain. So let me start by introducing one of the what I think are the foundations for this system, this sense of approximate numerical magnitudes. And I'm going to do it with a study conducted by Véronique Izard in a hospital in Paris near the Institut Nico, which is how you pronounce it. She did the study in Paris with newborn infants in a maternity hospital. In France, more so than here, they let kids stay in the hospital for a few days. So Véronique set up a lab there, and she would go around and look for newborn infants and wait for them to open their eyes. And when they did, she would pick them up, parents allowing. Parents tend to allow that. Well, they want to get some sleep when they've just had a baby. And she takes the baby to her lab and does the following study. The first thing that happens is the baby is lying in a crib, and she starts a recording of speech syllables. And for half the babies, all the babies hear sequences of speech syllables. Half of them hear sequences where they'll hear the same syllable four times before it shifts to a new syllable, which they'll again hear four times. The other half of the babies hear the same syllable 12 times, switching to a new syllable, which they'll hear 12 times. So all the babies are hearing the same syllables. The sequences are the same duration. Because the guys who hear four hear individual syllables that are longer than the guys who hear 12. But half of them are being familiarized with sets of 12 and half with sets of four. So after hearing those syllables for about a minute, Véronique shows babies one at a time a visual display. And in alternation, they see displays of objects that drift around on the screen. Half of the displays show four objects, and half of the displays show 12 objects. And what she reasoned was, if babies come up with a sense of approximate number, both for the sequences of syllables and for the arrays of visible objects, then they might show an attentional pattern that we will show as adults. If we are at the gym and we're exercising and there's two TV screens showing different programs about equally close to us, but our headphones are playing the soundtrack to one of those two TVs, we will tend to look at the one that's connected to the one that we're hearing, okay? Tend to look and listen to the same things at the same time. So she looked to see if the babies would do that, and she found that they did. Here are the babies in this 4 versus 12 experiment. Lumping over the two numbers, what you see is that babies tended to look longer at the display that corresponded in number to the number of sounds that they were hearing in each of these sequences. So having shown that with 4 versus 12, she went on to see how robust it was by replicating with 6 versus 18 and got the same findings. And then she asked, what will happen if we narrow the ratio difference? What if we do 4 versus 8? And now babies' performance declined precipitously, there's no longer a reliable differentiation at this age, from which she concluded that the newborn infants are distinguishing between large sets on the basis of number because their responses were not tied to a specific sensory modality or specific other auditory or visual dimensions of the displays, but they're doing so imprecisely with a ratio limit somewhere between 2:1 and 3:1. Okay, very imprecise representations of abstract number. Now, that's just one study. There have been many, many studies, most of them not with newborn infants, although the number of studies with the newborns has increased since she did that first experiment. Babies have been studied at a range of different ages. They've been presented with many different types of displays. They've been given different numerical tasks in addition to the numerical matching task. As in the Azard study, kids have been given tasks where they had to detect a change in number from one array to the next, or tasks where they had to determine whether numbers were changing in a progressive fashion, getting progressively larger or getting progressively smaller, or even in some studies they had to use the relative number of marbles of different colors to make inferences about if you were to reach in without looking, what color marble would you be more likely to extract from that box. And many, many different investigators did these studies. Actually, I wasn't involved in any of the ones on this slide. Many different investigators have shown with these different displays and different methods that infants are sensitive to number. They've also shown this with a bunch of different outcome measures, not just behavioral measures, also measures relying on signals ultimately produced by electrical activity in the brain or using other response modalities. And all of this work converges on the following general conclusions. First of all, these representations, which from now on I'm going to call ANS or approximate number system representations, we got to call it something. I don't want to just say number because I'm going to try to convince you a few slides from now that when we intuitively think about number, this is not the system that we're thinking about. So let's call it the approximate number system, the ANS, and take these studies of infants and ask what can we learn about them. Well, one thing we learned, I already showed you, that this system is imprecise. Another thing we learn from studies is that the precision depends on the ratio of the two numbers. So an infant who can just discriminate 8 from 16 can also just discriminate 4 from 8 or 16 from 32. And a third thing we learn is that the precision of the system increases as infants get older. So the newborns, as I showed you, require a 3:1 ratio, but by 6 months, the ratio is down to about 2:1 in most studies, and it gets narrower still as infants get older. Second, the system seems to be invariant over modality and format. So if you test a baby at an age where they can just discriminate between arrays of dots that differ in a 2:1 ratio, they will probably also just discriminate between sequences of sounds that differ in a 2:1 ratio. It seems as if it's the number that's determining the ratio and not these more surface properties of the arrays that they're enumerating. Third thing we find is that infants are not only able to compare numbers, they're able to add two numbers and compare their sum to another number. So if you present infants with a screen, show them an array that goes behind the screen, and then a second array that goes behind the screen, and then remove the screen and present an array that's smaller or larger than the sum, infants will look longer than if you present an array that corresponds to the sum, provided that the array that you present differs sufficiently for them to discriminate it. And then you can ask, well, how much does it have to differ? And the answer is the same ratio limit on numerical comparison seems to apply to numerical addition, but not to numerical subtraction. Subtraction is less accurate, so the differences have to be larger for the infants to succeed. And a final property of this system, number seems to be linked to length. And this has been shown using a number of different methods, but the basic idea is if you pair a large array with a long line and a short array with a small line, infants will generalize those pairings to new values of numbers and lines. But if you pair things in the reverse direction or you pair them randomly, they don't. So they're not just doing pair-by-pair learning, they seem to be relating these dimensions to each other. That's one source of evidence for this. Okay, so that was all about infants. Now, how do we know whether the same system exists in adults? Well, one way to find out is to test adults under the same kinds of conditions in which infants have been tested and ask, do we see the same patterns of performance? And in one way, we see very different performance in adults than we see in infants. We as adults are way more sensitive to numerical differences than infants are. If I show you an array like this, too fast for you to count it, and then take away 1/9 of the dots in the array and show you another array, most of you in the room will say that the second array is less numerous. You can discriminate dots at a ratio of 8 to 9 under many conditions, not always. That's pretty close. That'll be pretty close to your 7 to 8, 8 to 9 would be pretty close to threshold for most displays. But that's way more accurate than the infants are. So our precision is much higher. But qualitatively, we see the same effects in adults that we see in infants. So the critical limit to discriminability is the ratio. It's not absolute numerical differences, for example. We see the same modality and format invariance. We see the same patterns of performance on addition and subtraction tasks with adults that you see with infants. And we also see the same patterns of mapping arrays of dots by their number onto positions on a line, the same mapping between number and length, providing evidence, I think, that for a common system at work in infants on the one hand and adults on the other. Well, if the system is found in adults in our culture, it should also be found in adults in other cultures, including other cultures that are interestingly different from ours, for example, cultures where people don't have a counting rule. And they don't have a system of number words that is productive and captures number exactly the way our English number words do and most languages number words do. And also adults who have no formal education. Test those people and you see all the same properties of number representations that we see in adults in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and we also see them in other animals. This system is not unique to humans by any stretch. Trained monkeys in Liz Brannan's lab and other people's labs show very similar performance on all of these tasks to trained Duke undergraduates, okay? All the same kind of patterns of performance, and even animals more distantly related to us, like chicks and fish, show evidence for this system. So that tells us, I think, that this system isn't by itself the source of any uniquely human mathematical abilities, but it also tells us we've got now a nice method, further method for studying the properties of this system. We can use animals as models for testing how this system functions, for example, in the brain. Now, I think all the pictures on this slide are from studies of human brains, but there have been beautiful studies in monkeys especially, looking at brain mechanisms underlying sensitivity to number. There's an area in the human and monkey brain in the parietal lobe that is activated specifically when we're given tasks of comparing arrays of dots or adding them. We see the same this activity in the same region in human adults and in human infants, providing further evidence for a common system at work across these different ages. We see it also in children and in monkeys. So it looks like it's common. The neural evidence is providing evidence for commonality across development and across species, just like the behavioral evidence does. Finally, if you use transcranial magnetic stimulation or you take advantage of experiments in nature to study people with temporary or permanent impairments to that part of the brain where this region is, what you see is evidence for corresponding impairments in our abilities to do dot discrimination tasks. Now that's a finding that begins to suggest that there's some kind of causal work being done in that region, although it of course doesn't tell us what work is being done or what role this ANS system is playing in our ordinary use of number. Okay, so let me turn to the central question here, the question that's most important for this talk about the ANS. Do the representations of number, these approximate non-symbolic representations of number that we find in infants and in other animals, do they connect in any way to the intuitive natural number concepts that we can talk about with words and with other symbols and operate on, and that we operate on when we first learn symbolic arithmetic when we go to school? And what I want to suggest is that there's at least 7 kinds of findings in the literature that say these abilities are related to these abilities over here, okay? That these things are related to each other. And this has been a very debated claim in the field, as many of you know. So I want to go through each of these seven lines of evidence and see what you think. The first is a relatively recent one that comes out of Elizabeth Brannan's lab. She did studies where she is taking children that are about 2 years of age, children who are starting to learn the meanings of number words, but haven't learned very many of them. And in particular, the children that I'm going to show you data from have learned the meanings, it's reported by their parents and their performance on various word comprehension tasks show that they respond reliably with one object if asked for one, or two objects if asked for two, or three objects if asked for three. But for any larger number, they respond at chance. Okay, so they don't know larger number words. And then she presents them with an array of objects, one, two, three, four, five, or six objects. And she says, look, two, okay, or look, three, or look, six, okay? And on some trials, the number that she gives, like in this case here, correctly names the number of objects that they're looking at. On other trials, the number does not correctly name the number of objects they're looking at. They're looking at six objects and they're hearing look, three. And she continuously measured electrical activity at the scalp of the children as they're looking, locked to the point in time where they first hear that number word. And she looks for a particular scalp signature of surprise at an incongruent event. And what she finds is that kids detect the incongruities. That's not a surprise. After all, we've seen that you can ask them for three objects and they'll give you three objects, so they know the meaning of the words. But importantly, the degree of incongruity, the degree of brain response that you see to the incongruent trials scales with the numerical difference. So you see a bigger reaction to look three if you present six objects than to look three if you present four objects. Okay, that's the ratio property of the ANS. And she argues from this that the early word meanings are depending in part on this system. Here's the second piece of information. It comes from a study that we did with Camilla Gilmore some time ago. After learning that infants and also children if you present them with successive arrays of dots, they can mentally add them together and compare the sum to a third array, we asked ourselves, suppose we do the same experiment, showing them the same kind of animated addition trials, but instead of showing them dots, we give them number words and Arabic symbols. Now, to do this study, kids have to be 5 years of age, they have to be familiar with the Arabic symbols, and they have to know the number words. But importantly, we took kids who hadn't yet learned any symbolic arithmetic, and we give them these arithmetic problems. So Sarah's got 21 candies, she gets 30 more, and John has 34 candies, who has more? Okay. The first thing kids said to Camilla in these studies was, I haven't learned to do arithmetic yet, so I don't know how to answer these questions. Whereupon Camilla says, guess. And the kids guess, and they give answers that are utterly predictable from the answers they would have given had we presented them with dots instead of with number words and Arabic symbols, okay? Suggesting that the way they make sense of these properties is they've learned the meanings of the number words. The number words activate ANS representations of these numerical magnitudes, and those representations allow them to get to the approximate correct answer. Now, in support of that, when Camilla looked at the patterns of errors that kids made, she found out that their performance depended on the ratio. So they did better when the ratio of the sum to the comparison number was larger. She also found that the critical ratios were the same for this addition task as for a corresponding comparison task where all you hear is Sarah has 51 candies, John has 34, who has more? Okay. Addition and comparison gave comparable responses. Addition gave better responses than subtraction. They're showing all the signatures of the ANS in this symbolic task. And work by Bob Sigler has shown that kids also show the signatures of ANS representations if, instead of asking them to place an array of dots on a line, you designate a number by the number word and the Arabic symbol and have them place that on the line. And this is really interesting because in any real number line that kids see, the middle number between 1 and 9 is 5, right? That's what it looks like on a ruler. This is a linear spacing. But what the young kids tell you is that the middle number is 3, because that's what equalizes the ratio. 3 over 1 is like equal to 9 over 3, right? So they're not going with the experience they're getting from equal-spaced rulers. They're going with the relationships they get from the ANS at that early point in development. So aspects of symbolic mathematics seem to arise without instruction, and they're showing the signatures of the ANS. Okay, finding 3. I'm probably taking way too long here. I am, right? Yeah, I'm taking way too long here. I better go faster. You can predict school math achievement from ANS performance if you take a group of kids in kindergarten and early in the year, measure their performance on a dot addition task, and then at the end of the year, look at how their teachers evaluated their progress in mathematics. You find a relationship. You find that their progress in mathematics was predictable from their performance on the approximate dot addition task, and that's a prediction that survives controls for performance in literacy. And further work since then from Liz Brannan's lab has extended this and showed that not only do you see this predictive relationship if you measure kids at the beginning of the school year when they're 5, you can measure ANS sensitivity when an infant is 6 months of age and predict their later symbolic numerical abilities from that measure. And before that work was done, Justin Alberta showed that you can relate performance in these two types of tasks in the opposite direction as well. So if you know how well kids did in their math classes in school, in kindergarten or second grade, you can predict who will have greater ANS acuity at age 14. That's what he showed in this first study. There have been many studies of this relationship since then. It's found in adults. It's been found in a big meta-analysis. And it's especially dramatic in people with dyscalculia. Deficits in performing symbolic mathematics tend to have sharply lower ANS representations as well. I'm going to go over the I'm going to skip over the brain stuff because I'm taking too long on the ANS, and I'll skip over the Amazonians. No, I won't. Why might it be that when you do better at math in school, you later have a sharper ANS? What it suggests is that when you were learning math in school, you were activating these ANS representations, and they're acting like perceptual representations. The more they're active, the sharper they get. Okay, that's what it suggests. But is it right that we activate ANS representations when all we're given is a set of symbols and some symbolic arithmetic problems that we have to solve? Well, one way of trying to get at that is to go back to the natural experiment in nature done in the Amazon by testing Amazonian adults and their mathematical abilities as their ANS acuity as a function of how much math education that they've gotten. Now, the interesting thing about this group is that they're living in villages that are very widely dispersed, and there were only a few missionary schools that were available to these adults back when they were children. Whether a child went to school depended more on the accidents of whether they happened to be born into a village that was near a school versus a village that was far away. So some had no schooling at all, some had 1 or 2 years of schooling, some had more than that. So then as adults, their ANS acuity was measured and plotted against the number of years of schooling that they had. And what you see is this very nice relationship. It looks in particular as if there's especially a break somewhere between level year 2 and year 3 of formal education, which is interesting because apparently back when they were young, it was in that second year that arithmetic instruction began. The first task was to get these people to learn Portuguese, and that was the focus of the first year and most of the second year of schooling. But then subsequently they introduced math, and that's when acuity seems to really rise. In this graph, lower is better, so the acuity is really getting better in the people whose education continued long enough for them to get to mathematics. But let me end these first 6 cases with a warning. In one way or another, All of these sources of evidence linking the ANS to later symbolic math depend on correlations. They depend on patterns of association between these abilities. And of course, the first thing you all learned about correlations is they are not sufficient to tell us about causal relationships. There's just one set of findings out there that I think begins to suggest that the ANS has plays a causal role in children's symbolic mathematical abilities. And these come from studies that have given people training on ANS tasks and looked for effects of those training on subsequent symbolic tasks. The first and most systematic sets of studies were done in Liz Brannan's lab. But I actually want to talk about a study that was done by Dan Hyde in my lab because it was done on kids. Subsequently, other people now have gone on and done studies on kids as well. But I think he might have been the first to have done that. Anyway, he was the first that I knew about. What he did was he took kids who were 6 to 7 years of age. So these are kids who were already in the business of learning symbolic addition. Brought them into the lab and gave them animated dot addition tasks like the one that I animated for you where dots going behind a screen. Here's an example of one. Time is going downward. They're seeing the animation on a computer screen and they see two successive arrays of dots successively going behind the screen. And then they see a new array and they have to say, is it larger or smaller than the sum of the first two arrays? So one group of kids got training on that task, another group got training on a numerical comparison task, and then there were two groups that got training on tasks that had similar structure and rules but didn't involve number, a task of adding two line lengths together or comparing brightnesses of a single object that successively disappeared behind a screen. And after practicing one of those tasks, kids were given paper and pencil tests of symbolic arithmetic and also a reading test where they had to understand a sentence and fill in a missing word, show that they understood it by filling in a missing word. They were also given tests of ANS acuity. And what we found was that after these two tasks, kids performed better on the symbolic arithmetic task. In one study, they performed faster. In another study that emphasized accuracy, they performed more accurately than they did on either of these two tasks. Contrary to our predictions, turned out that comparison was just as good as addition in this task as a training manipulation. We also found no gain on reading or on ANS acuity. It was specific to the symbolic arithmetic task. This has now been replicated in three different labs, one in a study with preschoolers. Probably it's been replicated more than that because a lot of people are doing training studies now. One thing that's different from what we found, people who've done longer training have seen ANS acuity gains. Ours used a very brief training procedure. Finally, we and others have evidence that these effects are not placebo effects. It's not that kids do better at the symbolic math after doing the dots test because they believe they're more confident, they believe they should be doing better. Actually, they don't predict that they're going to do better, but they do. It looks instead as if short-term exercising the ANS is producing a short-term enhancement in symbolic arithmetic. Of course, this leaves completely open the question whether this exercise is at work in children's long-term learning of mathematics in school. That remains a fully open question. But it does look as if the ANS has something to do with our first system of explicit symbolic number concepts. But that was only supposed to be the first half of the talk. I'm going to have to truncate the second half here. The second half was to say that although the ANS is involved, it can't be even close to the whole story. Okay? Our natural number concepts cannot come from that system alone. Why? Well, for one thing, natural number allows us to enumerate things precisely, whereas the ANS is imprecise. For natural number, natural number obeys the logic of one-to-one correspondence. If two sets can be put in one-to-one correspondence, then they're numerically equal. But the ANS doesn't allow for representations of one or of one-to-one correspondence. It's inherently approximate. I could give you more evidence on that, but maybe it'll be clear from some of the work I talk about later. Third, natural numbers are related by successive addition of one, but for any number larger than 2 or 3, successive addition of 1 isn't even detectable by the ANS if you're a young child. That is, if you're at the age where you need to be learning the natural number system. So it doesn't look like the ANS could possibly be sufficient for the development of natural number. And that raises the question, what else is needed? Here's a system that has numerical content that Karen Wynn and Susan Carey and many other people, and Lisa Feigenson, and many other people have studied. It's not a number system. It's a system for representing objects, but it allows us to represent one, two, or three objects in parallel in a way that allows us to distinguish between those different numbers of objects and detect numerical changes in an array as one new object is added or another object, an object disappears. So, oh, and Christy, you've done studies like this too. So if Lisa Feigenson puts two cookies in one box and one cookie in another box, infants will crawl to the box with more cookies. By the time they're old enough to be in Lisa's studies, they can discriminate. They can also succeed with 2 versus 3. But interestingly, they fail with 2 versus 4, telling you right away that the ANS is not what's at work here, right? That just violated the ratio signature. 2 versus 4 should be easier if this were an ANS task. And they even fail at 1 versus 4. So the system seems to have a different set of limits from the ANS, a set size limit. It maxes out at 3. And it seems to be a system that allows kids to represent objects and their interactions, not specifically to focus on number. However, it is this system that in an indirect way captures numerical information and does so precisely. In fact, it's a system that could make you highly sensitive to the operation of adding one or to a representation of exactly one object. And although neither system alone could capture the logic of natural number, that raises the possibility that the two systems with their complementary properties could do so if representations from them could be combined. So how does that happen? I wanted to use just one experiment to illustrate that this is a slow process. It's not something that happens for kids overnight. And the study that I'm using is an experiment that was done on 3-year-old children by, again, Veronique Izard, using finger puppets. Here's how the finger puppet study goes. She presents kids with, it looks to me like a birthday cake, but she calls it a tree, with 6 branches, and with finger puppets, featurally identical animals, 6 of them that can sit on the branches of the tree. Then she says they're tired, they need to take a nap, so she and the child put all of the finger puppets into a box where they can go to sleep, and they sleep for a while, and then they have the joy of banging on the box to wake the finger puppets up, and Veronique and the child together take the first 5 finger puppets out of the box and put them back on the tree. And while they're doing that, Veronique deviously removes the 6th finger puppet out of the child's sight, which is extremely easy to do if you're playing with a 3-year-old, so that there are now 5 puppets on the tree and nothing left in the box. And she simply measures how long children search in the box for the 6th puppet, okay? And she compares that they might, of course, search in the box just because it's fun to search in a box. But to control for that, she compares how much they search in this case with another trial that's the same, except the starting number was 5 and there's no deception. So there only are 5 there. And what she finds is that kids search in the box at 3 years of age before they've learned the words 5 or 6 or learned to count. They search in the box longer when the starting number was 6 than when the starting number was 5. So what that tells us is they were able to distinguish these sets of 5 versus 6. And she went on to show that they do it by using the one-to-one correspondence relation between branches and puppets. Because when she changes from 6 branches to 11 branches, so now you would have to distinguish either 5 or 6 branches or 5 or 6 puppets, now kids fall apart. So the conclusion is they're using one-to-one correspondence to distinguish 5 from 6 at 3 years of age. So far, so good. Now let's ask, if they can use one-to-one correspondence to do that, do they understand the effects of adding or subtracting 1 to an exact set of one of these 2 sizes? So in one trial, she takes 6 puppets, they go to sleep in the box. While they're in the box, 1 puppet wakes up and he goes home, and now there's 5. Or that's compared to, we're going to start with five, they're going to go to sleep in the box, and while they're sleeping, oh, a new guy showed up late, he goes into the box and goes to sleep as well. All right? So will they be able to compute the correct numbers in these cases? Answer is no. They don't get anywhere close to them. But interestingly, if you reduce the numbers from 5 versus 6 to 2 versus 3, now you get the strongest positive finding of any of these studies. So it's not that the kids didn't understand the plus 1 and the minus 1 operation. It's that their representation of number in this case is not what we mean by number. It doesn't support the operations of adding or subtracting 1. But to me, the clearest case that shows this limit is the next study, which combined plus 1 and minus 1 together. So this is the last study I'll describe. In this study, we start with either on some trials with 5 puppets, on some trials with 6. They all go into the box, and then one of two things happens. In one condition, and when they come out, there's only 5 there, okay? But there's going to be 2 different conditions, and they're distinguished by what happens when the objects are inside the box. In one condition, a single guy comes out, looks around, decides he's still tired, and goes back in the box, okay? In the other condition, one guy comes out, he goes home, another guy comes in, and he goes into the box. Now, misleadingly, it looks from this animation as if this event had more going on than this event, but actually Veronique set it up so that the amounts of visible motion and the narration was the same across these two conditions, but one of them involved a single object that was removed and returned, and the other involved 2 different objects. This is called the single object one, the identity condition, because the same individuals are involved throughout the study, and the other case, the numerical equality condition. Now notice, from the point of view of natural number, these two conditions are identical. They both involve a set with addition followed by subtraction of 1. Okay, but one of them involves the same objects and the other involves different objects, and that ended up making all the difference. Kids succeed at the identity task, they fail at the equality task. And I think what this is saying is that these children are representing exact sets of objects and relations of 1-1 correspondence, but they're not representing exact numerical equality. They have an understanding of this task as a task involving transformations on objects, not as a task involving transformations on number. Or to put it another way, they're missing fundamental pieces of the logic of natural number. So how do we arrive at this logic? Well, kids pass Veronique's exact equality task at about 4 years of age. And in general, what predicts success on this task is how many number word meanings children have learned. If you go into the Amazon, as Julian Hara Ettinger and his collaborators have done, now into a population in the Bolivian Amazon that's going to school, to Spanish-speaking schools, learning number numerical language in Spanish, but like the earlier Amazonian group, beginning their education at very different points in development, and therefore learning number words at very different times in development, they're passing the exact equality task later, but their success on this task also is predicted by their numerical language, how many number words they have come to master. And finally, work with Susan Golden Meadow and her collaborators, especially Alicia Spapin, shows that if you study home signers, you find some home signers who never develop a consistent, productive numerical vocabulary, and they never seem to pass tasks that require this basic logic of exact natural number, namely that 1-to-1 correspondence guarantees exact numerical equality, all of which suggests that natural number concepts connect somehow to language. Well, what could that connection look like? Let me end with a hypothesis about it. I think children construct the logic of natural number in 4 general steps. So in step 1, and all of these steps involve natural language, in step 1, they learn a set of count nouns, that is, noun phrases, nouns that appear in phrases that refer to single individuals. Like a cup, or the cup, or this cup, or, you know, one cup. All of these phrases pick out an object, a body that's distinct from other bodies. If it's an artifact like a cup, it's an object that has a function for our actions. If it's an animal like a cat, it has a whole set of behavioral functions for its own purposes. But so somehow we're involving the core object system, a core action system, either our own actions or the actions of the animal we're picking out, and a core system of geometrical form analysis. Each of these words is referring to a thing whose characteristic function is made possible by its characteristic form. And I think kids learn these mappings by mapping singular noun phrases to these core representations of objects and actions and geometrical forms, but that would be another story. Step two, though, is they map noun phrases now to arrays that pick out more than one object, that can pick out two objects or three objects. And initially, I think, most of these phrases don't use number words. They say things like your cup and my cup, or the red fish and the blue fish, or this cat and that one, okay? But that's a single noun phrase that's picking out two individuals. And then you could, once you have those phrases, you also can come, children also can come to see that people will introduce number words in this context. They say, do you want this cookie and another one? Yeah, you want two cookies, right? Or look, the red fish and the blue fish, there's two fish here. So these start to alternate with each other, and kids get the idea that number words can pick out sets of exact numbers of objects. And I think this is coming entirely from mapping to this system for tracking objects over time, but it paves the way for step three. In step three, as in the Brannon studies I told you about with the show two objects and say look six, in step three, kids take these same representations that they can construe as an object and another object, or two objects in the exact parallel, you know, object representation sense, and map them to representations from the ANS. So now, when they hear a cup and another cup, or they hear an expression like two cups, that comes to be an expression that both picks out an exact number of objects and a numerical magnitude. In the case of two cups, a magnitude that's larger than the magnitude picked out by one cup and smaller than the magnitude picked out by three cups. Now, that's as far as the kids can go using just the properties of the two core systems, because we're now going to be running up against the ratio limit of the approximate system, and we're running up against the limit on the number of objects that you can represent in parallel. But there's one more step left, and what I think it is that kids come to learn that in the same way you can use expressions to pick out two objects, the red fish and the blue one, John and Mary, this cat and that cat, you can use expressions to pick out two sets of objects. You can say, three cookies and two more, or two pairs of shoes, okay? And in this way, what language leads kids to are the operations of addition and multiplication. Because what you're doing when you say three cookies and two more is adding two sets to form, two sets each of which picks out an exact numerical magnitude to form the superset that also picks out an exact numerical magnitude and that you can also call by the, you know, name by the expression five cookies. Okay? So the idea is that language leads kids to apply the operations of addition and multiplication to small numbers to yield larger numbers. And because the operations of addition and multiplication have no upper bound, there's no limit to the number of times you can apply them, this supports the intuition that exact numerical magnitudes also have no upper bound. And all of them will inherit the logic of the small numbers. So just as the kid already understands that a set of three diminishes in number if you take one away. Remember the early finger puppet studies, they got that one right. Now they know that a set of three and two more distinguishes by one if you take one away. The larger numbers inherit the properties of the smaller ones. Okay, so on this hypothesis, and I am done now, natural number concepts depend on three universal human cognitive systems, the two core systems that I talked about, and natural language. And they also depend on learning. They should only be found in humans who've mastered a natural language that has these properties. If we can find humans out there who haven't mastered that much of a natural language, they won't have these abilities. And I think some of the home signers are in that category. Finally, it's an account that doesn't appeal in any way to explicit teaching, even teaching of accounting routine. Now, counting routines are going to be really useful to kids. Arithmetic instruction is going to be really useful to kids, because although you can get the intuition that three cookies and two more yields an exact natural number, if you want to know things like, do three cookies and two more yield the same exact natural number as two cookies and three more? Which is a bigger number, three threes or four twos? Nothing about the logic of language gives you the answer to that question. To learn the answers to those questions, you have to learn how to count, you have to learn how to do arithmetic. So I think those are important skills, but I don't think they're the source of the fundamental construction of the natural number concepts, the fundamental insights into the logic of natural number. So this is the hypothesis that I think suggests answers to those first four questions that I started with. First of all, what allows us to develop new systems of knowledge in general? Well, in the case of number, we do it by combining productively representations that are delivered by our core systems using the productive rules of natural language, rules that allow us to say John and Mary, or this cat and that one, get harnessed to give us the combinatorial logic of natural number. Where do abstract concepts come from? Well, on this account, they come both from the core systems and from language learning. The representations that the newborn infant has of four versus 12 syllables or objects already is abstract, but very limited in its application. When that gets combined with other abstract concepts via language, you come up with a much more powerful system of those concepts. And how do we learn new numerical concepts? I think by using the combinatorial power of natural number to combine our old concepts in new ways. Finally, does numerical cognition have universal properties? And here I think the natural language system will be universal across every human who has access to the ordinary kind of language, you know, input from which we can learn any natural language. But it won't be found in people who don't learn a natural language. And the subsequent elaboration of that system can vary enormously across culture and education and so forth. Now, I don't have time to talk about it, but I think a similar story I could have spent this hour telling you a similar story about the construction of Euclidean geometry from two systems that solve different problems, that operate on different features of the environment, and that capture different properties and relations, but that come together as we learn terms like long, which can or big, which can apply to a feature of the environment like a mountain, or to a feature of an object like a big cup. And as we learn spatial symbols especially that can connect our representations of large-scale space to our representations of small-scale space. And finally, I think the same kind of account might work for accounting for uniquely human aspects of social cognition, that we may start out with these two distinct systems for representing people as agents on the one hand who act on the world efficiently and as social beings on the other. Two systems that answer different questions, that analyze different aspects of people's behavior, and that capture fundamentally different sorts of mental states. For the agent system, the kind of states that a guided missile or a robot could have, intentions, plans. For the social system, the kind of phenomenal experiences that we only attribute to ourselves and I think to our potential social partners. But with language and other symbols, these two systems can come together, and we can come to see instrumental actions as having social meaning and social actions as serving to advance our instrumental goals. So all of this, of course, is a work in progress, despite lots of research and 50 years of progress, I think, in studying cognition in human infants. We still don't know whether any account like the one that I've given is correct. But what I hope I've shown you is that we can do research, especially when we do multidisciplinary research, coming at this problem from multiple angles, that can move us forward. If the accounts I've given are wrong, I hope you feel that the kinds of methods that have been used to support them could be used by you to show the ways in which they're wrong and to get us closer to an understanding of the nature of our belief systems and their origins and how we come to have the kinds of minds that we have. I think it's a really wonderful field to go into, and I think we have very, very rich means at our disposal right now for addressing these really hard questions. So thank you. I think we're born mathematicians at all. And actually, I think people find all of the constructed concepts hard. Okay, think about social reasoning. Okay, some people are much better at social reasoning than others, but I think we all find it hard if we start talking about my belief about your assumption, about my argument, about your, you know, I mean, we don't have to go up too many levels before we all start exploding, right? I mean, mental state reasoning can be extremely hard. I think geometrical reasoning can be extremely hard. I don't know if any of you have seen this, but Plato's original argument for the innateness of Euclidean geometry in the dialogue between Socrates and Meno's slave was recently replicated in Argentina. And guess what? If you're an educated, college-educated Argentinian adult who has fully survived high school geometry, you are no better than Meno's slave at answering Socrates' initial questions. You make all the same errors that the slave made. And worse yet, after getting through the whole dialogue, the Argentinians did something that Socrates never did, but should have done since he was supposed to be such a great teacher. They drew, the way the proof works is Socrates draws a square in the sand, and the task is draw another square twice as large. And they have to go through this whole dialogue before the slave supposedly comes to see that if you draw the square on the diagonal of the one that was in the sand, you'll get one that's twice the area, okay? So he goes through the whole thing. And just like Meno's slave, the Argentinian adults say, yes, I understand now. I understand your proof. I get it, all right? He says, okay, great. I'm going to draw a new square over here. Now draw one that's twice as big. And half the people get it wrong, okay? I mean, one of the ways geometry is hard. Number is hard. Uniquely human social reasoning is hard. What the babies do is not hard for us. It's easy, but it's extremely limited. It's pieces of what we do. When we say number and geometry and social reasoning are hard, we're talking about the constructed systems. What the babies are doing is easy. Nobody finds that hard. People come into my lab for adults for our studies of spatial reasoning, and they say, oh, I'm terrible at getting around in space. I'm going to be awful in your studies. And I can say with confidence, no, you will not. You will find the corner where your keys are hidden. And they do, right? Because that's a task that animals can pass and that young children can pass. But these are extremely limited pieces of the representations. I mean, they don't even get you. The two core systems I talked about today don't even really get you to the concept one or two. Because what we mean by those concepts is both. We mean a set with an exact cardinal value. And that's not in either of these core systems. You only get that by combining productively the information from those systems. So I don't actually think there is a contradiction here. And I didn't mean the takeaway message to be babies are smart. I mean, they are. They're cool and they're smart and they can do all these neat things. But they're also incredibly stupid. I mean, what they're doing is really limited. Look, they don't even know that if you take one guy out and put his friend back in, you've got the same number that you started with. So, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Method that you use in the infants. Mm-hmm. And for the experimentation, it's really convenient that babies have this, but I was thinking ecologically it's kind of inconvenient because a lot of times it doesn't hold, so there's one bird going toot, 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 toot.
Absolutely.
How do babies use this? Yeah, absolutely. Do they break this?
Absolutely. And I should say, these studies have been replicated many times on newborn infants, but I don't think they've ever been replicated on older infants. And I don't know that people have tried. We tried once a long time ago and got into a blind alley. Before these studies were ever done on the newborns, I had given up on doing on getting at number with cross-modal matching because I concluded you would never see this in older infants. And I think it's for that reason.
There's
very, very few that show any cross-modal effects with older infants. We had done some 25 years ago, and then somebody replicated them and got the opposite effect, and someone else replicated it and got no effect, and I kind of tore my hair out and stopped citing that phenomenon until Veronique did these studies. I believe these because they've been replicated a whole bunch of times, but here's how I think about them. I think the infants' representations they're newborn infants. They have extremely low acuity. In their auditory acuity isn't quite as bad as their visual, but really in every modality, these are very, very imprecise, non-specific representations. I don't think it's anything like a representation of 12 syllables, okay, or 12 squares on a screen. I think they're very, very non-specific. And the reason you get it to work at that early age is that all the more specific relationships that the later kids have to learn about depend on information that isn't even getting through to these infants. They're only getting the crudest sense of what they're hearing and what they're seeing. But that crude sense is enough to distinguish elements that differ in number by these huge ratios, right? 3 to 1 is an enormous ratio. I mean, even for an older infant, certainly for a child.
One question that if it's just the newborns, there's so many things that need to be controlled, like as you showed that some of the objects are made larger so that the smaller number will have equal
right.
number, but then you've got a sparseness issue.
Yeah.
It's like almost impossible.
Yeah, one of the reasons I talk about that study as opposed to, you know, there were like a gazillion studies on the next slide that I didn't take you through. One of the reasons I talk about that study is that I actually think it's convenient that the newborn infants have such impoverished representations that they're able to do the cross-modal matching. Because when they match across modalities, it actually reduces the number of other stimulus features that you have to worry about. So you don't really have to worry about size. There isn't really an analog to size in the auditory dimension. You could worry about things like extent, which could mean either like extent in time or extent in space. So that got controlled for.
But it looked like they changed the size of the dots. Mm-hmm. Varied that randomly or something, right?
I don't think they varied it randomly, but they did experiments two different ways. They did experiments where the total overall size was held constant, which meant that the more numerous arrays had smaller dots, but they also did studies where like the one I showed you, where dot size was constant, which meant that the more numerous arrays had larger dots. They did it both ways. Yeah. In the studies with older kids, I actually think the continuous quantity controls are more satisfying, but it takes almost half the talk to go through them all, because you have to worry about density, you got to worry about size, you got to worry about spatial frequency. It's complicated. But people have worked hard at it, and I think there's pretty much consensus at this point that all those other factors can be controlled for and don't account for the discrimination. Yeah. Yeah, I could have given a whole talk on this. I actually think that the exact number representations that we form as adults continue not only to depend on language, but on a specific language. And the evidence for this comes from studies of bilinguals. So this is a point where any of you out there who are bilingual can tell me if I'm saying something wrong. Usually, I can tell who's bilingual because people start nodding, yes, that's right, okay? That people who are equally comfortable speaking two different languages, but who learned elementary arithmetic in one of those languages, will use the language they learned elementary arithmetic in when they're adding up a bill at a restaurant, even if the entire conversation at the restaurant is taking place in a different language, and they're equally comfortable in that language, but not when it comes to doing arithmetic, okay? And similarly for reading dates, you know, where you need the exact number, you know, it's 2012, not 28 election we're talking about, right? If that was if you think about that date in a different language habitually, you'll go back to that language if you're reading a text and you suddenly see it. So I actually think it continues to depend on language for adults. We studied this at one point because there were various theories about why that might be, including that it's just a habit. You know, you're just in the habit of adding in one language, not another. And we showed that that wasn't true by taking, I mean, that wasn't the explanation. By taking bilingual adults and teaching them new arithmetic facts, some of them in each of the two languages, and then the, you know, whatever habits they had from beforehand are neutralized. They just have the new experience of learning new facts, and they're learning some in each of the languages. Yet when we later query them on them, they're faster to retrieve the facts in the language we presented it in than they are in the opposite language. So I actually think it's even more language specific than I would have predicted, you know, before getting those data. But I think that's probably be, I hope that's consistent with the story I'm trying to tell here. I think it's universal across languages that languages have nouns and they have noun phrases, but it's not universal what the structure of those phrases is. So sometimes the determiner comes before the noun in some languages, after the noun in others. So you end up with expressions that are tied to specific natural languages that you learn. And I think, you know, that's my best hunch as to what's going on. Now, there's a line of work that's been taken to provide counter evidence against the idea that we continue to rely on language. So there are some people who think language doesn't play a role. Steve Pinker, who was here recently, I think, believes that language doesn't play a role in any of the things that I'm talking about, right? It's just a useful way of talking about number. It doesn't actually give us our number concepts. Set those people aside. There's a bunch of other people who argue that, yes, I'm convinced language is crucial to the development of these concepts, but it's just scaffolding. Once you've got into the domain of abstract number, you no longer need language. Stan Dehaene is a prominent person in that category. And I think he's right about a lot of numerical reasoning. I think he's right about the kind of numerical reasoning that a mathematician does, which relies very heavily on spatial representations and higher level patterns and relationships that don't get easily captured in ordinary natural language discourse, right? I think he's right about that. But when it comes to the natural number system, the thing you learn not as a mathematician, but as a four-year-old, okay? In that case, I actually think it continues to play a role for us throughout our lives. But the reason many people don't think that is that studies of, you can get rather severe impairments to your language abilities without losing your arithmetic abilities. So there are people, and actually Stan Dehaene and I studied them, who have damage to language who do show impairments to arithmetic. But there are also cases of people with, for example, profound autism or profound aphasia who continue to be able to do arithmetic. The thing is, though, they're also able to do, although they have dramatic language impairments, the impairments are not total. And they also tend to be able to handle simple noun phrases, which is what I think is critical. So I think the jury's out on that one, but my bet is on the language, you know, is central, not just when we're learning natural number, but when we use those concepts as adults. That was probably a way too long-winded answer, sorry. Okay, thank you.